So here's an interesting Java interview question. There's a task running in a separate thread, and your job is to stop the task if it exceeds 10 minutes. So basically we have a thread, let's say the main thread, that's going to start another thread, which will actually run the task. And then after a certain timeout, in this case, it's 10 minutes, you want to be able to stop that particular task. So let's divide the problem into two parts. First part is, how do you stop a particular thread? And the second part is, how do you do it after a certain timeout? So let's start with the first part, stopping a thread. So let's say we create a new thread in our main method, which is our main thread. So we are going to create a new thread. We are going to submit a runnable to it. And in that runnable, we'll have all the steps which are there in a task. In this case, it doesn't matter what. And then we are going to start that particular thread. Once we start the thread, we want to wait for 10 minutes. And then we want to stop that particular thread. So to stop the thread, all we have currently is the handle of thread, which is T1. So let's see if there are any APIs in the thread class, which will help us stop the thread. And the short answer is no, we do not have a stop method in the thread class. Okay, so we cannot really kill a thread or stop a thread. So what other alternative do we have? So let's say instead of a raw thread, we can try something else. Let's try a thread pool instead. So let's say we create a thread pool and we are going to submit our task in the form of a runnable to that particular thread pool. So now it's thread pool's responsibility to assign a thread to that task and to run that task. We'll have a timeout of 10 minutes. We'll discuss that later how. Once that 10 minutes has passed, we are going to stop the task. So for a thread pool, we could do either a shutdown or we could do shutdown now in an attempt to stop the threads which are running our task. So now the question is, if we execute the method shutdown or shutdown now, does it really stop the thread? If we check the actual documentation of shutdown, it says it does two things. First, it will not accept any new task that you're going to submit to the thread pool. And two, whatever previously submitted tasks are there in the queue, which are not yet executed, it executes them. Okay, so it does nothing about stopping any of the existing tasks. If you use the shutdown now method, it will return any of the tasks which are waiting to be executed in the queue, and any of the tasks which are currently being run by the thread are just attempted to stop. So shutdown now does not guarantee that it will be able to stop the thread, and that is, it will be able to stop our task. So using even a thread pool is not going to help us. So what's the third option? Maybe we could try something like a callable instead of runnable. So we'll use the same thread pool, but now instead of submitting a runnable, we're going to submit a callable. If we submit a callable, the thread pool returns us a handle in the form of a future. And future class has this method called cancel. So maybe after waiting for 10 minutes, if we do future.cancel, it will stop the thread. But again, if you check the documentation of future, it does not guarantee that it's going to stop the task. It will only attempt to stop the thread. Okay, so that brings us to the first lesson, which is Java threads cannot be killed. Okay, they are cooperative in nature. So for a thread to stop, someone needs to ask politely. And the way to ask the thread to stop is either using interrupts or using volatiles. So let's start with the interrupts. So for using interrupts, we'll create a new thread, we'll wait for 10 minutes, and we are going to call the interrupt method on that thread. And the task itself needs to listen for the interrupts. So within the task, we need a condition, an if condition, saying that is the current thread interrupted? If yes, that means that someone wants me to stop doing what I'm doing. And then it's up to this task's responsibility whether to return or whether to continue. In this case, we know that the timeout has passed and we want to stop the task, so we'll do a return. But if we observe closely, we are doing this check only once in between step 2 and step 3. So if our current task is between step 3 and step 4, it won't get an opportunity to test whether it has been interrupted. So instead, we'll use a while loop. So we'll keep checking whether the thread is interrupted. And if it is not interrupted, then we'll perform the next steps. So let's say we have 10 steps in our task. After every step, we are going to check if the thread is interrupted. If not, we'll continue with the step. And if the task is interrupted, will just come out of the while loop and the task is finished, and by default, the thread's job is done and it will be killed. And in fact, this concept of interrupts is what is used by every other concurrent utility in an attempt to stop the thread. So we spoke about how ThreadPool.shutdown now does not guarantee the stopping of the threads. And that is because all shutdown now does is internally it will go to all the threads and will do a thread.interrupt. That means that even if we use the thread pool, within the thread pool task also, we can apply the same concept of checking for interrupts. So when we do thread pool.shutdown now, internally it will apply the interrupt and our task will catch that interrupt. It'll come out of the while loop and that particular task will be marked as complete. And the exact same thing with future.cancel. So the same example that we saw earlier, where instead of a runnable, we had a callable which returned a future, and after 10 minutes we were attempting future.cancel. And when we have the parameter value as true, that means that whenever cancel is called, internally whatever thread is running our future related task, that particular task is interrupted. So even here, if we have the check for interrupts, we'll be able to come out of the while loop and we can complete our tasks. So interrupts are one of the ways to check if some other thread wants us to stop. The other way is to simply use a volatile variable. So let's say in this example, instead of using Java 8 lambdas, we are going to have a class called myTask that implements runnable and it overrides the run method. And all the steps which are involved in the task are mentioned here. But these steps are run only as long as the variable keep running is true. And this variable is public and of the type volatile. So as a task, it is saying that I'll keep running until the value of this volatile variable is true. Just start a raw thread with that task. And after 10 minutes, if the main thread just changes the value of this volatile from true to false, since it's a volatile, when the thread T1 reaches the while loop again, it will find the value of keep running as false. And that is when it will come out of the while loop and the run method has been completed and the thread automatically dies. And since volatiles and atomic booleans are very similar, we can replace this volatile with an atomic boolean and the entire code will remain the same. So either we use atomic boolean or volatile, it really doesn't matter. So in all these earlier examples, we assumed that our task is running some Java operations as a set of steps, and after every step we had a while operation where it checked for the interrupts or the volatiles and it performed the next step. But what if instead of Java operations it is doing some IO operations? So let's say in this case our task, instead of doing some Java operation, is making a stored procedure call, which is a database operation. And let's say this stored procedure is very slow and it takes more than 10 minutes. In that case, our thread will be stuck at this point and it will never be able to reach the while again to check if there is an interrupt or a volatile change, right? So it's important to confirm that it's not an IO operation. It has to be a Java operation so that you can keep going back to the while loop. So in such cases, the libraries itself, like the JDBC library and HTTP client library, they have these timeout methods where you can specify the maximum timeout you can wait for this operation. So now that we have understood how to stop a thread, let's go back to the second part of the question, which is you want to be able to do that only after a certain timeout. In this case, the timeout of 10 minutes. And this part is relatively straightforward. So the first option we have is we start the thread and for the timeout, we just say thread.sleep for 10 minutes. So this will make the main thread sleep for 10 minutes. After it wakes up, we can use any of the previously discussed methods to stop our task. We can also use a scheduler service for it. So here we have a scheduled executor service where we are scheduling stopping of our task after 10 minutes. So we are saying that run this particular operation after 10 minutes, and within that operation we are saying task.stop. And third, instead of runnable, if you have a callable where you get a future object, even the future object has this method called future.get, and you can give it a duration. And in this case, we can say, get me the value of this future and wait maximum for 10 minutes. If in that 10 minutes, you do not get the value of the future, then there'll be a timeout exception. And within the timeout exception, we can use the same thing as earlier. Either we can use future.cancel or we can use the task.stop using the volatiles. So that's it. That's how we solve this particular question. So that's it for this video. This was a very interesting question to me. If you have any similar interesting questions that you want us to solve together, please let me know in the comments. Thanks a lot for watching and see you in the next one. Bye.